Thank you so much for that, Mr. President. Dumelan Botswana, Ministry of Health, dear colleagues, dear participants, and guests. I will talk a little bit about the importance of the evidence-based guidelines, treatment guidelines, and screening of serious pathology. I wanted just to thank ISSLS as they have promoted my travel funding here, and I wanted also to give the report that we are presenting at the annual meeting in Scottsdale, the first report of the Mahalapia conference in USA, and then follows the Eurospine and the North American Spine Society, and that gives personal reports also. The development and evaluation of an innovative, integrated, low-technology, low-cost model of care to improve the management of spinal disorder in underserved, treatment-naive, vulnerable populations with the goal of reducing the associated global disability and burden of disease is absolutely novel. The initiative here uses evidence-based medicine recommendations. And in many times, these evidence-based recommendations are actually measured in what we call QALY. And QALY, as you can see, are disability-adjusted life years, is a measure of overall disease burden expressed as a cumulative number of years lost due to ill health, disability, or early death. So what you do is that you take the year lived with disability plus the years of life lost. And this is a measure that is internationally used all over the world. That means that if there was to be a study set up, we can use this and compare with other countries. This is also one of WHO, for example, is main measures for outcome right now. And if you look at the word map through DALIs, you can see that the dark red Zimbabwe in this case have 80% out of 100 who have lost DALIs due to different disability or early death, while the yellow areas run about 9 out of 100, and then there is a scale in between that you can compare your country or other countries with when you look at the disability cost and the burden for the persons. How do we then find the evidence-based medicine for low back? And I'm going to focus mostly on low back pain and take some examples from neck pain also. But where do we find all these evidence? Well, you can see the red circles. We find a lot, of course, in countries in North America, in Canada and USA. We found a lot of our evidence in Europe, the whole Northwest Europe, but even though in Iceland. We find it in Australia and New Zealand. And we see that the smaller circles here are emerging countries where research starts to pop up and to be of excellent quality that we can incorporate in this evidence-based guidelines. Most evidence-based guidelines choose to evaluate English-speaking articles or studies, but we have also guidelines group that at least cover 4 or 5 languages. So if we look a little bit at history, what does it mean with the history of the guideline? Well, in 1955, there was about 347 trials of excellence reported. If we then go to the 1970, they started to produce and to publish therapeutic guidelines. 1984 was the first low back pain guideline by Beagles et al. And Boss, Scott and I was on that guideline. 1995, the evidence-based medicine exploded, you can say, particularly with the articles from Davido, Sackett, and Haynes et al. 2000, the first national guideline clearinghouse, which is up and running for the national, for the United States, was founded. 2002, you had the Guidelines International Network with a very spiffy name of CHIMP, with 6,700 guidelines on their website that you can access, and 48 countries are participants from all continents. 2010, we think that we have approximately 50,000 new clinical trials a year. This is not just specific for low back pain, but all diseases. And in 2010, we believe that there is 500,000 existing clinical trials in the world that has been published. In 2013, we believe, although it's difficult to count, that there are about 400 spine guidelines synthesized from clinical trials evidence. And these may be published or they may not be published, and it's only those guidelines that are published or that are recommended on the website of a government or a large association that is accessible to other people who would like to learn about guidelines and how to use them in this treatment. So in the neck pain task force, where Scott Holderman was the president, we sifted through 31,878 citations. Of those, about 1,200 were relevant, and of those, we had a system that we could screen these articles with 2 to 3 people, and we accepted 46% of those articles as good articles, and that can form as a basis of the guideline in the future. And you can see here that there were about 249 in epidemiology, 95 in diagnosis, 17 prognosis, 117 in intervention, and 113 in economic cost. And we may see other subcategories in the future. So what is a guideline and how do we use it? Well, a guideline is a medical treatment guideline. They're written from clinical perspective to guide and provide the best clinical care that are sifted from the evidence-based material from an international multidisciplinary team who has said this is the best article according to certain methodological rules. The medical guideline has many names. It can be called clinical guideline, clinical protocol, or clinical practice guideline. It's a document with the aim of guiding decisions and criteria regarding diagnosis, management, and treatment in specific areas of healthcare. Guidelines are evidence-based, and if no evidence exists, they are consensus-based, which means that you bring a group of experts that can agree or not agree, that happens also, right, on the best type of treatment. So the spine guidelines that are existing today may include non-surgical or surgical treatment for spine. So you have these more comprehensive guidelines, and then you have smaller guidelines for specific disease complex or disorder or a procedure. Some guidelines are for specific condition, others for more non-specific spine conditions. Guidelines ought to be updated every 2 to 3 years when new evidence is available. That would be commendable if you can update the guideline to every 2 to 3 years, because then you have a number of new evidence that is present. Some spine guidelines have been implemented as state or government recommendation to improve care and to curb costs. So the recent clinical spine guidelines summarize and evaluate the highest quality of evidence and most current data about the prevention, diagnosis, prognosis, therapy, including dosage of medication, risk and benefit. Does this recommended treatment do any harm to the patient? It's equally important as if it's beneficial, right? It also looks at cost effectiveness. It identifies all possible decision options and the outcomes in clinical care. It usually contains an algorithm, so when a patient information through the algorithm. It intends to standardize care and improve quality of care, and it intends also to provide a balance between cost and medical parameters such as effectiveness, specificity, or sensitivity. And it actually nowadays also takes into account the patient preference of care. So who issues or releases clinical practice guidelines? Well, government and states, national institute, defense system, professional association, insurance companies, hospital entities, scientific publication, and network. But they must be published. Otherwise, nobody knows about this guideline. This is, for example, the Defense Department in the United States. This is a guideline that came up also the Parliament in England and was approved for the whole English national system. And this is, of course, the different journals that are producing and publishing or publishing the guidelines with the evidence and the references. The content of the spine guideline is usually the background, the scope, description of the disease, assessment of the disease, principles of management, description of the best evidence management, when to refer, what are the harms, and what not to do, and what to exclude. What don't we do anymore that we did 10 years ago? I will take one example. I will take the NICE guideline for low back pain, and I will then compare it with the current guidelines today. This was done by the National Institute of Health and Clinical Science in England, and it was discussed in the Parliament, and it is now used actually by most of the healthcare system in England and has been completely adopted. And this guideline covered background, scope, key priorities for implementation. So this was something that would help clinicians to implement in their clinic. Pharmacological therapies, non-pharmacological therapies, cost and saving, a discussion that was available, and a section on how to find out more, meaning websites, references, etc. You've heard this again, but this guideline presented the background about low back pain, and what is it? It's now a couple of years old, it's about 10 years old. This guideline covers early treatment and management up to about 12 months, from 6 weeks to 12 months. It does not cover management of severe disabling low back pain that has lasted more than 12 months. So it was really a more primary care guideline, you can say. They defined non-specific guideline, and this was an agreement among the task force, tension, soreness, or stiffness in the lower back region, for which it isn't possible to identify a specific cause of pain. And the specific causes of low back pain was not covered by this guideline, which include malignancy, infection, fracture, perhaps ankylosing spondylitis, other inflammatory disorder, and other disorders that would be common, for example, here in the SPADA, tuberculosis, HIV, AIDS, and perhaps others. So here comes the triage that was common and that has been somewhat updated. And the triage was really based on back pain. Was there a red flag, meaning malignancy-specific disorder that needed to have a specific treatment? And we believe that that's about 10% today. The non-specific group is about 90%, where we need to give the advice to maintain activity, have low-cost treatment that I will show in a while. And out of this comes the disc pathology, which is about 5 or perhaps a little bit more that can be treated by expectancy or have to go to surgery if the neurological compromise is progressing in particular. Scott Horneman has updated this just recently, 2012. And here you can see that the spinal disorders with serious or systematic pathology is more detailed. Congenital and developmental abnormalities, neoplasm, infection disorder, systemic inflammatory disorders, and serious trauma. We expect about 2%. at least in the literature that is cited here. Spinal pain referred from non-spinal pathologies added, that is abdominal and pelvic pathology, may be presented as spinal pain, about 1 to 2%. Spinal pain with neurological deficit varies between 5 to 8%, perhaps a bit depending on what literature you look at. And non-specific spinal pain remain the big chunk of patients, which is about 90%. So the spine guideline, or the NICE guideline said, keep diagnosis under review all the time, promote self-management, offer drug treatments as appropriate, offer one of the treatment options listed on next slide, considering offering a second tour of these treatments. And these treatments, this has been in, you can say, practice now for 10 years, and these guidelines was developed in the late 1990s. So provide people with reinsurance and education to promote self-management. Offer one of the following treatment options, taking patient preference into account, 2002. An exercise program, a course of manual therapy, a course of acupuncture, and if it's not the satisfactory outcome, what do? You start again. And the clinical community was not necessarily happy with this over the 10 years. So how has this changed? Well, there has been guideline updates and synthesis. So there are two very excellent articles, one from the group in Oregon, that is Chow and his colleagues, for evidence from non-pharmacological therapies for acute and chronic low back pain, a review of the Society American College of Physician Clinical Practice guidelines. And then Dutch Nice, who is a colleague and a researcher with Scott Holdman, the synthesis of recommendations for the assessment and management of low back pain from recent clinical practice guidelines. And this synthesis looked at 10 guidelines according to this review system that is very stringent, and it's called AGREE, where you compare guidelines, but you also see that the methodology is acceptable, is commendable, is approved by methodologists, so we know that this is a good guideline. This is what has happened over 10 years. So the NICE guideline, 2002, assessment recommendation of various scores. History and clinical examination were not specified. But what they had was that they recommended no x-ray for non-specific low back pain in the acute stage of about the first 4 to 6 weeks. In the synthesis of all the guidelines by Dajunayev, you can see here that the emphasis of triage is explicit and detailed. The history and clinical examination, it is now recommended that this was a physical and neurological clinical examination. Rule out serious pathology and know what you are ruling out and the epidemiology of your country. Look for specific causes for low back pain, and if you cannot find them, then that's okay. There is no specific cause. Look for neurological involvement. Is this perhaps something that needs surgery or other treatment? Identify risk for chronicity, such as the perception of disability. If that is very high, it's hard to get a good outcome. The fear of movement or catastrophizing or a true depression. This has been, you can say, the most predictive of all spine care that we do has been the psychosocial factors. So we have a good understanding of that, at least you can say in most westernized countries, we don't have perhaps enough understanding in other parts of the world. When it comes to the treatment, the NICE guidelines, treatment less than 12 months, was patient education and reassurance, exercise, at this time, start the early manual therapy, which was a conglomerate for manipulation, mobilization, and massage, acupuncture, acetaminophen first, and NSAID and short-term opioids if necessary.
Repeat if not successful.
The synthesis 10 years later tells us both still remain patient education and reassurance, a very important component, short-term acetaminophen or NSAID, spinal manipulation. And spinal manipulation include mobilization, but massage is no longer here, but it may come back because there are some good studies coming out on massage now. Treatment for chronic, you can now see it's divided in acute and chronic. So we do something the first 6 weeks, and then we change in the next 6 weeks. That means we can continue with this regimen for a bit more, perhaps a few, two or three weeks more. Same as above, but we add exercise, and we may have to add cognitive behavior therapy, which is really problem solving, relaxation, and stress management. And possibly a short term of opioids. However, we have had some papers that are indicating now that opioids should be prescribed as little as possible.